Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi on this episode of Insight, Betrayal, dealing with duplicity and the challenges of moving on. Hey Dad was one of the most successful TV sitcoms in the 80s and the 90s. When did the abuse start?
He would always have me on his lap. He would always be touching me. This photo, you can see his hands, like, basically on my vagina underneath a script.
Do you think he intentionally betrayed you?
Yes.
Everybody that I met, I had the intention to betray.
You become a practice liar and thief, so you get pretty good at it.
What has betrayal done to your life?
It's destroyed it. I just really exist.
Sarah, welcome. You were a child star in the Australian TV series Hey Dad. How old were you when you started?
I was 6 when I auditioned, and then we did the first series when I was 8.
You played the youngest daughter, Jenny. What was it like in the beginning?
I would say it was fun as a kid. It was very different. I'd already done a lot of modelling and TV commercials, but then this was in front of a live audience. It's kind of exhilarating because you've got that live audience, but the rest of the week is just kind of tedious.
Your on-screen dad was the actor Robert Hughes. Here's what happened to him more than 2 decades later.
Hey Dad was a top-rating family comedy through the late 80s and early 90s. Behind the scenes was a terrible and dark secret.
I'm absolutely, totally shocked at the allegations, and I absolutely deny everything.
4 years ago, we took the unorthodox step of naming former Hey Dad star Robert Hughes as the man accused of multiple counts of child sexual assault, both on and off the set of the top-rating sitcom during the 1980s.
Its star was a paedophile, preying on his on-screen daughter, targeting her, abusing her.
After using his position of power to exploit vulnerable children, the past has finally caught up with Hey Dad actor Robert Hughes. He was sentenced today to more than 10 years in prison for sexually abusing 4 young girls in the 1980s.
After 6 weeks in court, the jury took just 11 and a half hours to decide his guilt, that he abused at least 3 of the 5 young girls who are now women, still carrying the emotional scars of his terrible crimes.
Sarah, we saw you there acting in Hey Dad, as well as the reporting on Robert Hughes's crimes on Channel 9. When did the abuse start?
I guess in today's terms, what we know as grooming began right from the very beginning. The first series, my dad was alive, and he died between the filming of the first series and the second series when we came back. And I think he saw that opportunity in the middle to become like the father figure in real life. But there was always, he would always have me on his lap. He would always be touching me. And then it just progressively got more and more. This photo, you can see his hands, like, basically on my vagina underneath a script. And this was out the back of the set in front of everybody. So that's how brazen he was.
What happened when you were 12?
It was a production break, like, everyone was on lunch. And he walked out, dropped his pants, waggled his penis, like, at the mirror, looking me in the eyes, and I got up and ran to makeup, and I was like, Robert just showed me his penis. And everybody just kind of flipped out, and they locked the makeup room, and everybody knew, pretty much the entire TV station knew what had happened at that point. And then we had already had discussions with the producer, but this was like, look, it's obviously not just touching. Like, there's big stuff going on.
Did you tell anyone higher up at the network at the time?
I told Gary Riley, who was the producer, and then I know that he had discussions with people about being the highest rating TV show in the country at the time. It was kind of just brushed over as, we're not going to destroy a TV show because a kid's being molested. There was a whole discussion, and I had gone into Gary's office and I'm like, this is what's happening. And we had a whole thing about, you will no longer have to sit on his lap. They started making it so that we weren't together in scenes. They didn't have anything where he would have to touch me anymore. They knew what was going on, but then their basic thing was, don't ever tell anybody about it because you'll never work again.
The show's producer has always denied saying that, and that while he knew of the allegations, without a formal complaint, he couldn't do anything. Robert Hughes played your father on television. Did you also see him as a father figure off screen?
The network really tried to play that angle because we always did the Father's Day events, and since I didn't have a dad, they always tried to be like, oh, he's like her, you know, taking over that position. But no. I mean, in some ways there was things like, I remember fondly, like he taught me how to tie a knot and things like that. So there was that, and like, you know, like helping me tie my laces, things that I guess a father could have done. But at the same time, it was very much like, I work with you and no.
Did the fact that your own father had died make what Robert Hughes was doing to you an even greater betrayal?
He was supposed to be that father figure, and he's trying to portray that in the public as that father figure. So it kind of tosses that line between a random person and almost the incest side of it, because he is so close.
You told your mother what happened. How did you feel about her response?
She just said, stay away from him, which is fairly worthless when you're working with somebody. So I just disregarded what she thought because she wasn't really helpful.
What were the discussions about whether you would go public or not?
We don't know where are they now, and we all said that we would do the show as long as Robert wasn't there, which got everybody questioning how you could have a Hey Dad reunion without the dad. So it took people like 5 minutes to work out what had happened.
You stayed working on the series until you were 15. What did you do after that?
So I left the show because it was obvious that I was never going to win this battle. I didn't also want to stay in Australia because everyone would be like, why did you leave the highest rating TV show? So I went on student exchange to Honduras for a year.
And why Honduras?
It was one of the few countries where Hey Dad was not shown.
Jordan, 6 months after you broke up with your ex-partner, a friend of his contacted you. What did they say?
He contacted me to let me know that my ex-partner had been saying stuff about me that he didn't believe was true, and he wanted to let me know what was going on.
And what had been going on?
There was periods where he was telling people that we weren't together when we were. He had told people that I had Hep C, and he'd seen paperwork in my house, which obviously I knew was not correct.
How did that make you feel?
Betrayed, a bit confused, put me on alert and kind of made me go, well, OK, what's the reason behind all of this, and, you know, what do I need to figure out?
And what did you decide to do about that?
Made an appointment with the GP. We'd been together for maybe about 5 years or something.
When you went to get that checkup, what did you find out?
So originally I was pretty much assured by the GP that I had nothing to worry about. I was young and healthy and everything was great. And then I got a diagnosis of HIV positive.
How did you feel when you got those results?
I think shell shock is probably the first thing that happens. You just shut off. Very confused, really didn't understand what was going on. Yeah, your brain doesn't even work.
Who did you tell first that you were HIV positive?
Coincidentally, that was my ex-partner.
Did you encourage him to get checked?
That was something that doctors were asking me to try and find out. So repeatedly had requested for him to get checked.
What did doctors think about your diagnosis? Where did they think you'd probably got HIV from?
They said, chances are it has come from your ex, so they really wanted to know if it was something that happened soon or if it had something that could have been years ago.
Did your ex get tested at the time?
No. He repeated stories, I've been really busy, too busy to go get tested, and it was just week after week leading into months of excuses of, yeah.
Doctors believed your ex had given you HIV. Did you have any further contact with him?
During that period, his new partner was overseas. There was a one-night stand fling that happened while the partner was away. Looking back, was very... it was designed, it was planned.
In what way?
He had tried to make it happen.
What happened after that one night stand?
He had waited until his partner had come back from overseas. I believe he arrived on a Friday and they had a conversation about the fact that he had been with me and the partner had been with other people while overseas, so they decided that next Monday, well, they would both go to the clinic and get checked themselves.
And what were the results from that?
They both came back positive.
And your former partner did get a call from a clinic. What did they say to him?
Stop whatever you're doing. Come straight to the hospital. They're expecting you.
And why did they want him to get there so quickly?
He was late stage AIDS and viral load was in the millions. So it was very late stage.
So how long did that suggest your former partner would have been HIV positive for?
Everyone is different, but in general they were suggesting 8 to 10 years.
Do you think he knew he was positive while he was in a relationship with you?
Absolutely.
How do you sum up how your ex betrayed you?
Complicated. Somebody that I still care for deeply. And it wasn't the transmission of HIV in general. It was he had gone over a couple of years to great lengths to try and set me up and make it appear like it had been from me.
Kylie, in 2014, you were diagnosed with stage 3 cancer. What was it like to hear that news?
It was pretty shocking, obviously. At the time, I was a personal trainer, so I was probably what appeared to be in the fittest, healthiest stage of my life. If you looked at me on the outside, everything would have appeared to be perfect. So hearing that I had cancer, it was a real complete and utter shock.
Given how fit you were, how did that make you feel about your body?
Well, completely betrayed. I was in such shock that for the first, you know, probably 3 weeks having appointments with the doctors, I kept saying, you must be wrong. This has got to be something other than cancer. I can't have cancer. I'm too healthy. I do all the right things. We don't drink a lot. I don't smoke. I exercise daily. I eat well. Like, people like me don't get cancer.
What treatment did you end up having?
I had an 18-month protocol of chemotherapy almost daily. I had, I think it was 27 lumbar punches in the end, where I was having chemo injected straight to my brain just to stop the spread of the cancer. So it was pretty brutal. It was a very full-on protocol.
Did you look for any other treatment options?
Definitely. I thought the doctors have got it wrong. You know, surely there has to be an alternative. And, you know, there's always people say, you know, have you tried the healthy route, things like that. And a friend of mine had introduced me to Belle Gibson. She had heard of her in the media and said, look, this girl's got brain cancer and she's treating it holistically. Maybe you need to have a look at that. And at this stage, you know, I was bald. I had put on, you know, nearly 30 kilos from the steroid treatment. I didn't look anything like myself. And there's Belle Gibson travelling the world, looking amazing, fighting brain cancer, which, you know, seems to be a more aggressive and horrible cancer than what I had. And I thought, well, if she can do it, then I'm going to do it.
Belle Gibson claimed she was managing cancer without medical treatment and gained a huge following. What was she promoting that appealed to you?
I guess just that alternative to the chemotherapy. She was saying, you know, you can treat it by naturally looking after your body, eating a holistic diet, really steering away from the conventional medicine, because that's what in the end was destroying me.
Did you ever contact her directly?
I did. I contacted her over social media. At one stage, she'd put a post up commenting that she had gone into hospital. I think it was on her son's birthday. And I had sent a message saying, that's really sad and how horrible. I had 3 boys as well, excuse me. And, you know, I just sent her best wishes. And she replied saying, thank you. And that was sort of the contact that I had with her.
Did you ever give her money?
Yes. Yes, we donated to her fund. Not a lot, because at the time, obviously, I wasn't working and the costs were piling up for us as well. But, you know, I just felt so sad for her, because I thought, well, she's doing it tough. She has this young son. So, yeah.
What did you later discover about Belle Gibson?
That she'd lied about it all. That she had faked having cancer, that she had befriended a family whose son had brain cancer, and she lied about the treatments that she was having, copying the treatments that he was having. She would say that she was going to have all of these operations and procedures, which just wasn't true.
When you realised that she was a fraud, how did that make you feel?
I was furious. It just felt like another kick in the guts, I guess, because I had put all this hope into her having all of the answers, and then to find out that she was a liar, and not only that she had lied, but all of the people that I had trusted to, I guess, do fact-checking to make sure that she was who she said that she was. You know, she was being published by Penguin Books. She was going over to America, and Apple were putting her on the Apple Watch. So if these big companies weren't checking her facts, you know, it was... I felt let down by several people.
Nikki, you grew up with your mum.
Yeah.
What were you told about your father?
I was told that my father died on Christmas Eve before I was born. My mum had said that she had met him while she was travelling.
What was it like growing up without your dad?
It was the 80s. It was pretty confusing. Kids could be quite judgmental. I had a lot of questions. I often felt like I didn't really belong in my family for various reasons. And I felt like some of that was, you know, evidently genetics. I had a void, a deep sense of wonder of who my dad was.
Did you ever want to learn more about him?
Absolutely. And I was constantly asking questions. So my mum told me that he was Canadian, his name was David Spears. She even told me he was a Sagittarian. She said she met him in London, she loved him. When I started getting more curious, I asked how she found out that he died. And, you know, there was a couple of different stories I heard. The police contacted her. She said that his parents called. I was like, well, if his parents called, how come I can't call them?
You started doing your own research. What did you end up finding?
Nothing. Like, there was no evidence of someone with that name dying on Christmas Eve in London. I couldn't find him on birth, deaths and marriages. I looked through stuff. When the internet started becoming more of a thing, I started looking through things from the UK, things from Canada, and there was just never any information.
Your mum got sick and died when you were 40.
Yeah.
What did you decide to do after that?
So 2 weeks after she died, I ordered a DNA test. Lo and behold, the results came back.
And what did they say?
There was a close match, and it seemed like it was a first cousin. As the next 24 hours kind of went on, I realised that first cousin was potentially my brother. And so I tracked him down on Facebook and sent him a DM and said, hey, I think we're related. He responded pretty quickly. So we chatted for a bit, then he called me. And so we worked out we were siblings.
Wow. What did he tell you?
He was alive, yeah. So I found out my dad was alive. He and my brother were both living in California. And, yeah, so he was alive. He'd had a stroke and was quite unwell for various reasons.
How did this make you feel about your mother, who had told you for your whole life that your father was dead?
So my relationship with my mum was pretty tricky. My mum was a pretty tricky woman. And while she was on life support, I'd done a lot of forgiving. And so I felt like that ripped everything out from underneath me. The opportunity to know not just my father, but my brother, my children, to have the opportunity to know their grandparent. There was lots of layers of betrayal, like so much of the things that my mum had told me and these elaborate lies over my lifetime made me question everything that I thought I knew about our relationship, about myself. It was pretty awful. Mm-hmm.
Why do you think your mum betrayed you and lied to you about your dad?
I'm not really sure. She was a complicated person. I wish I had those answers, but only she has those.
Keith, you describe yourself as a professional betrayer.
Yeah, professional betrayer is appropriate for what I was. I started working as a deep undercover cop when I turned 22, working in the criminal world buying heroin.
Is it weird that I got married young? Like, it makes you second guess yourself.
There's this perception that marriage ties you down.
I was thinking that this is the end of my single life and I'm not experimenting with other people.
Sex is sacred and the Bible teaches that marriage is a covenant.
The marriage is not only the boy and the girl, it's a union for two big families.
Oh my God, Indian parents, so dramatic.
Bring it here. Come on.
I live by myself.
Bring it here. Drop it. Cooper.
If it wasn't for work, I would spend all my time on my own.
Drop it. Drop it. Drop it.
I purchased the block in 2006 and it was for Jared. I call it Jared's place. My son Jared died on the 30th of May 2019. He's 8 weeks prem, so this is when we just when he finally came out of the human crib. And he's a baby. I would describe Jared as kind, caring, loving. Like to think he was wise. This is his first day of school. It's a couple of merit awards that he got from school. Great friend, and an amazing son. He was the golden child of my whole family. He was the one that first finished school. He was the one that, was captain of his school. That had never happened in my family, so he was precious to us. All of them are special. All come with memories. The things I struggle with since he's passed away, I can't go for a swim in the beach. I just can't do that anymore. I know that it'll be too painful to go there without him. I miss everything about Jared. I miss his cuddles, I miss his kisses. Yeah, I miss hearing his voice. The impact from the betrayal from the former government has had a devastating impact on my life. It's pretty much destroyed my life as it was. I'm just living day by day and existing, really.
Kath, in May 2019, your 22-year-old son, Jared, contacted Centrelink. Mm. What was he told?
He'd been applying for Centrelink and he'd received a rejection. So when he called them on the... We called them on the 30th, he basically spoke to them about his statement not having a BSB number on it. Jared got quite angry with them because he said, "You've already got my BSB. The bank doesn't give me a statement with the BSB on it." So when he got angry, they hung up and then we rang them again. So we had two lengthy phone calls. And at that stage, there was no debt mentioned by Centrelink or by Jared.
A bit later, he came out of his room. What did he say to you?
So he came out and said that now he owed Centrelink $2,000 and he wasn't going to get paid.
What did not getting that New Start allowance mean for your son?
He'd been in Albury, he'd been bullied at work and broken up with his girlfriend, ended up homeless, come back to me, and I wasn't working at the time either, I'd lost my job. So he was kind of feeling like he was a bit of a burden on me, and he had some fines and he had a loan and he was worried about defaulting on that loan.
That afternoon, his behaviour changed. Yes. What did you notice?
He started to catastrophise. He was becoming a bit aggressive and I wouldn't say panicky, but it was kind of, he was running out and asking me, "Can you have a look at this cover letter?" And then I looked at the cover letter and it kind of come across very desperate. And when I gave him some criticism about that, he, started swearing at me saying, "You think you know everything." And so his behaviour become out of character for him.
Did he stay in the house?
No, he didn't. He left and I thought he'd gone to cool off. I just didn't really understand what was going on. And I noticed that I'd had a message on Messenger from him saying, "I love you." And I thought, great, he's calmed down. I'll just go to bed.
What happened the next morning?
So the next morning he wasn't home, and I started to try and call him, and his phone went to message bank. I thought, OK, his phone could be dead, he could be out of friends. And I called Janet, and we just started to discuss what could have happened, where is he? We started to discuss that his wallet was in his room, and I said, well, he wouldn't have taken his wallet anyway because he didn't have any money in it. But Janet was saying, you should, I think it's time to call the police. And then I'd had a message from my goddaughter saying, is Jared okay? I just got a text message saying, stay strong, I love you.
When you heard that from your goddaughter, what did you do then?
I thought, no, that Jared wouldn't do anything like that. I don't know what that's about. Like, if that was a goodbye text, like, I didn't think he'd harm himself in any way. It just wasn't, it's not something I thought Jared would ever do. From there, once I called the police, I started to get worried then. I started to think, well, where is he?
32 hours later, there was still no sign of your son, Jared. What did you do then?
The police called in the morning. And they said that, I said, have you found him? And they said, no, we haven't started looking yet. And I basically said to them, I can't wait for you to go look for him. I'm going to have to go and start looking for him myself. So I discussed with the policeman. He said, just go to some places that he might regularly visit. So I took the dog for a walk. And I went through the park. I couldn't see anything. And then I just thought, oh, I'll just walk around this path before I leave. And as I walked around the park, I could see what appeared to be a jumper in a tree. And I thought, oh, it might be his jumper, so I went to go and check it. And as I got closer, I seen his face.
In the days after Jared's death, what did you realise?
I was kind of in shock and terribly distraught. It took me a few days, but I started to realise what had happened that day, like the phone calls, and then I realised that I had a look at my phone and went, oh, hang on, that was the same day, and this is what happened up to the lead-up of him taking his life that night.
A reporter later told you about the former federal government's robo-debt scheme. This was an automatic debt recovery program. Mm-hmm. Had you heard about that before?
No, I hadn't. I was too busy working. I didn't watch the news much.
And this scheme was based on an incorrect algorithm and subsequently it was ruled illegal. What was your reaction when you learned about that?
When it was deemed illegal, I burst into tears and I was angry. I was really angry that they'd continued to do this for, I think it was 4.5 years. And they had warning signals earlier that people had taken their life over that, but they'd just completely ignored it.
Was there a tipping point, do you think, for your son?
Yeah, it was the thought that he wasn't going to get paid because he owed them $2,000.
How do you feel about the former federal government, which oversaw that robo-debt program?
I feel they betrayed everyone. I'm just so angry at them. I just, you know, I believe that they, you know, some of them are still saying it wasn't our fault. We were led by the departments, but they're the ministers. And if they had have inquired early and had a look at this system properly, then I believe I'd probably still have my son.
What has that betrayal done to your life?
It's destroyed it. It's completely changed it. I just really exist. Because I miss him, you know, I miss him every day, and he was my whole world was built around him.
Kath, thank you. Keith, you describe yourself as a professional betrayer.
Yeah, professional betrayer is appropriate for what I was. I started working as a deep undercover cop when I turned 22. Initially, my job was to penetrate areas to buy a lot of cannabis, and then I moved into working in the criminal world buying heroin.
So you had to have a fake name, a fake identity in that time?
Yeah, I worked under an assumed name. I think from memory I may have had 3 or 4 different assumed identities, depending on the operation.
How did you betray people while you were undercover?
The difficulty of working undercover is that everybody that I met, I had the intention to betray. Whether I was introduced to them by another drug dealer or whether I managed to penetrate the network. Every single person that I met, I knew fully that they would be arrested, so I had every intention of betraying them whilst acting as their, sometimes their friend, certainly spending time in business dealings with them, completely lying to everybody I met.
When you say betraying, what were you betraying?
Everything. Whilst they were engaged in illegal activity, particularly those who sold heroin, I had no remorse about, but their trust, their confidence, they bought my story essentially. So I worked my way into their entire network.
Did you ever regret those betrayals?
Given my attitude now towards drug reform, now I do, some of them. There were people I met who were making a business and making a living out of selling heroin, which resulted in the deaths of many people. Back in the 1980s, there were overdoses every day. Mm. But there were people who were selling cannabis, not to make a fortune, probably to supplement a lifestyle. Some of them were struggling. And I look back on those days and I regret betraying them.
Are there any cases that you still think about from your time as an undercover cop?
I'm haunted by one. I was on the Gold Coast sourcing vast quantities of heroin that were very, very pure. And in that network was a young man who I thought was around 18. He wasn't a user, he wasn't a dealer, he was just on the periphery. And I connected with him because he was a troubled kid and I'd had a troubled childhood. And I was in a house one night where I'd bought heroin and I had to sit there and watch two people shoot him up or inject him with heroin because he'd been assaulted by his father and they thought that was the way to make him feel better. I couldn't interfere with it. After the operation was over and I went back to normal policing, I kept track of him informally. And he died of a heroin overdose 4 years later. And I found out that he was 14 when that had happened to him.
Did it ever get to the point where you thought twice about betraying someone?
Not in the undercover world, no. That was the job I had to do. It just became harder and harder. And like every other undercover cop that I've ever spoken to since that time, we all feel the same way, that setting out to betray someone is not, it's not an easy thing to do. It's not the normal activity of a human with any sort of emotional intelligence. But it's a job that had to be done in that era.
Did being an undercover cop impact your life outside of work?
I withdrew from my social circle. I told my social circle that I'd been kicked out of the police force because they knew me as a uniformed officer before I went undercover. It was more so after I finished undercover. I had a sense of distrust of everybody because I knew fully well how easy it is to betray people. So I found it really difficult to trust people, to let my guard down. And it changed me in that way. I became cynical and jaded and, yeah, pretty mistrustful of the world for a while.
Because you knew that they could betray you.
Absolutely. And I guess working in an environment in Queensland in those days, there was a cohort of corruption and there were some detectives in the drug squad who were probably putting more heroin back on the streets than we were taking off it. I felt betrayed as an officer with integrity, even though I was an undercover cop, and I just felt that I was out there betraying people and changing my lifestyle and in order for the greater good. And in the meantime, there were some police who were probably worse than the dealers I was working on.
Fred, when did you start gambling?
I started gambling, say, informally when I was 9. We were watching the grand final and I remember an older gentleman walking around with a hat and there were some, you know, you put coins in the hat and you get a Norm Smith medalist out. And I remember that I got the winning player, Andrew Embley, in 2006. And I remember it lit my brain up like a Christmas tree. And there was other little events like that when I was young, like someone giving me a scratchy inappropriately or a lottery ticket. But it started full on when I was 14.
At what point did it start to become a problem for you?
When I finished school, I was really disengaged with the academic system. And I just knew that that wasn't going to be the way I spent that year and I wanted to do something else, and that's kind of where gambling came in.
And so what were you betting on at that time?
It started with footy and soccer because that's what I grew up loving and being obsessed with and knowing about, and it was my vice from my disengagement from the classroom. But it quickly manifested and turned ugly and went out of control, became everything. Came casino, online casino, dogs, horses, poker, everything.
Your dad died when you were 13 and you received a large inheritance when you turned 18. What happened to that money?
Over the course of 2015, the year after I finished school, I lost the whole inheritance. That was about $220,000.
After betting away that inheritance, how did you then start to fund your gambling?
I started borrowing from my mates and, even worse, stealing from my mum. And when it came to repaying my mates with the money that I'd lost, that I'd borrowed from them, I actually came clean to my mum about the money that I'd borrowed them. So she actually repaid that because she was kind of soft and free-spirited like I am, and my dad was kind of the strict disciplinarian, you know. And she repaid them, and what made it even worse, my betrayal, was that even after she repaid them, I stole from her again.
So she's lending to you to pay them back and you're stealing from her
yes.
at the same time?
Yes.
How would you do that?
A couple of ways. I had accounts in her name. I would take her card to the ATM and use her PIN and pull out cash. I'd take cash from her wallet. You know, you become a practice liar and thief, so you get pretty good at it, unfortunately. So any way that I could steal, I would, to anything I could do to fund my compulsion. And it was, yeah, it was really, really ugly and regrettable. It was a really dark period of my life.
How much did you end up stealing from your mum?
Probably stole around $25,000.
At that time, did you consider that you were betraying those closest to you, your mum, your friends?
I think I knew subconsciously what I was doing was wrong and I wasn't happy deep down, but my conscience was with gambling and my motivation and my impulse was just to gamble. And I was, yeah, I was lying to myself that I could turn it around, that I was smarter than the system. Like, I had gambler's logic. I can turn this around. You know, if the more money I get, the more opportunity I have to win back the money I'd lost, pay everyone off and, you know, be the hero that I want to be. But that just wasn't reality. That was just a fallacy that I was inflicted with, and it just came unstuck.
You decided to stop gambling. Why?
Probably the third time I stole from my mum, I saw a side of her I've never seen, which was very serious. You know, she said, if you do it again, I'll call the police and press charges against you for theft. And I think my self-preservation just kicked in and go, all right, now it's time to change, and I feel this. Because I think it's very easy when you're gambling through chips or through a screen to distance yourself from your loss and what you're doing. And it's a lot harder when you feel it yourself, you know, like I've lost everything and now I feel it. Okay, now it's time to change. So that was the moment I decided to invest in a different, in being someone else, you know, doing something else with my life. And, yeah, I suppose that was the day I decided to try and start turning my life around.
Did you feel sorry for stealing from your mum?
I did. I felt exposed, you know, the fact she caught me. You know, it was like living a double life, like this big lie that I'd created that I was some heroic gambling winner and the way I wanted people to see me. And it was just a lie. And I felt exposed. But in another way, it was kind of the day that I felt free, that I'd been caught. Everything that I'd done was there to see, and there was no more hiding in plain sight. So even though the day I got caught was embarrassing, it was also the day that I got set free.
How did you and your mum overcome your betraying of her?
It took a lot of time. We went to psychiatry, which was for me, and initially she was with me in the room, and it just took years and years and years of commitment to my psychiatric journey and just repetition of trustworthy actions. And I think over time that just naturally rebuilt the trust and respect to now the point that I don't think she's told me she doesn't feel the need to check her statements or count her cash for the last few years. And that's something that I'm embarrassed that she had to before, but I'm proud that I have the self-control that I've rebuilt that trust with her. And we have a really amazing relationship now.
And how long has it been since you've stopped gambling?
I haven't gambled in 6.5 years, which I'm very proud of.
What do you like doing with your mum?
I like doing lots of things. We have Mondays is just for us. We have lunch together. We have a half day off, which is nice. I like just being with her. I like laughing with her. I like talking about our dog with her. Lots of things.
Keith, you were an undercover cop for 2 years before you decided to work elsewhere in the police force. What was life on the force like after that?
I used to think I came through it fairly unscathed until I started working my way through post-traumatic stress in the last 5 or 6 years. I realised that when I went back into normal policing, I was cynical, I was jaded. I was 24 years old, cynical, jaded, distrustful, rebellious, and I needed adrenaline. I had a thirst for adrenaline, and that moved me into special weapons and operations, which then sent me down a path of tactical work, which I loved, until a gun battle in 1987 where one of my colleagues was killed and the offender was killed. And then I had years of what I now understand as post-traumatic stress. So, yeah, it was challenging.
Your undercover work was more than 40 years ago now.
Yeah.
Do you still feel like that even today, that sort of cynicism or that distrust?
I'm so fortunate. I met a psychiatrist who helped me. She actually diagnosed me with post-traumatic stress disorder. I've now discovered what it's like to be joyful again. I love life. I do things for me. I do things for others. I have a great relationship with my children and my wife that I didn't have for a long, long time. So I'm very, very fortunate.
Apparently it's quite normal for parents to disengage from their children. But I think there was a bit of a betrayal there that when I probably needed her the most in life, that she chose to say that I was the bad person for going public.
Sarah, Robert Hughes spent 8 years in prison for sexually abusing 4 girls, including yourself. Did he ever admit his guilt?
No, he still pretends that he's the victim to this day.
What happened to your relationship with your mother after you did go public with those allegations against Robert Hughes?
We've never spoken since.
Did that feel like a betrayal in a way to you?
A parent's supposed to be there for their child, I think. But I've learnt from other people who've been through it that apparently it's quite normal for parents to disengage from their children. But I think there was a bit of a betrayal there that when I probably needed her the most in life, that she chose to say that I was the bad person for going public.
You live in the US now, you married an American. Why do you think you made those choices?
It wasn't until my husband had to give a police statement, and he said something about, because I'd never dated an Australian, and he thought it was because I couldn't stand having the Australian accent touching me. And so because that was, you know, the thing, and I just never wanted to date an Australian.
Do you have children?
I do not. I have a dog.
You have a dog. Robert Hughes was released in June last year and he was deported to the UK. What's next for you?
So now that he's no longer on Australian soil, it was like this relief when he was released. He actually got released a year early for his parole, but it was almost relief because you go through the court and everyone tells you once someone's found guilty that it should be over. And it wasn't for any of us, because then he's in prison and there was constantly things in the media, and then you've got to go through every year there's a parole hearing, so it brings everything back up again. And then he was finally deported. And so now I'm actually going to try and move back to Australia, because he's no longer, I don't have to share earth with him, and Australia feels very nice again now that he's not here.
It's a place you want to come back to.
It is. It's home. It just didn't feel like home for a long time, because there was that betrayal of the industry who turned against me when I went public. I was slandered for years until he was found guilty. And then even the betrayal of all these people who knew that he was guilty have never apologised. I've never received an apology from Riley or from Seven or from all of the people back then.
Jordan, you tested positive for HIV after being infected by your former partner. Do you think he intentionally betrayed you?
Yes, he had spent quite some time over a couple of years trying to make sure that I would take the fall for it, essentially. I still don't know specific details of when he knew for sure, but it was definitely while we were together. And a lot of things that he had covered up.
He later died of AIDS. What were those final weeks like?
After he was diagnosed, he probably had about 6 months. So the first three was regular trips to the hospital and more stuff coming up. Pneumonia, and then they recognised he had lymphoma, and there was a lot of other stuff. And then at around Christmas, New Year's, things had gotten quite bad, but then as he was getting worse, he distanced himself from friends and family, didn't tell them the whole truth, tried to act like he wasn't as bad as he was. I was pretty much the only person that he had at the time.
Your former partner claimed that you gave him HIV. How did you feel when he died?
Everything. He was still the person I cared about the most. You know, we'd had developed something beyond a friendship, beyond a partnership, and it's taken a long time to come to terms with it.
So he was probably one of the closest people in your life?
Yes.
What impact has his betrayal had on you?
Well, on the negative side, we're looking at complicated bereavement, panic disorder, PTSD. So that still affects me and probably will for a very long time. On a positive note, it also sent me into the HIV sector last year, working as a peer. So I was able to assist other people. And yeah, that was quite rewarding.
You're now living with HIV. What's that like for you?
It in itself doesn't bother me. I'm on medication. Most people will take one tablet a day, every day. That means they get to a level where the virus is so low it's undetectable. That means it's untransmissible, so they can't pass it on to their partners. I myself am on injectable treatments every 2 months. I get 2 injections and I'm good for another 2 months. So it doesn't really affect my life outside of that.
And do you mind me asking if you're dating again?
No. Haven't really since. With everything that went on, it was just I had other things to focus on and it's not really on the cards.
Kylie, you were diagnosed with cancer 9 years ago and you started following now discredited health influencer Belle Gibson. How close were you to giving up your chemo and following what she did?
Incredibly close. It was a discussion that I'd had with my doctors and my husband, and I had said that I'd had enough of the conventional treatment and I wasn't going to do it anymore. It was just by, I guess, good management that they were able to talk me around and, you know, convince me. I remember a nurse saying to me, I can either nurse you through the chemo and through the cancer or in palliative care. It's up to you. That's your options. You know, if you stop treatment, you're not going to survive this.
So you continued that conventional treatment?
Yes.
What do you believe would have happened had you taken Belle Gibson's advice and stopped the chemo?
Oh, I would have died, for sure. There would have been... I wouldn't have been able to survive it. It was too aggressive by the time that I caught the cancer that, yeah, there was no coming back other than from having the chemo treatment.
How is your health now?
Perfect. Good. Yeah,
that's great.
All fine.
In remission?
Yes.
Nikki, your mother betrayed you by saying your father had died in a car accident. Decades later, you discovered he was alive, he was living in America. What was it like when you spoke to him for the first time?
It was incredibly surreal. So the first time I spoke to him was my 41st birthday, and it was the day after getting my DNA results. So all that happened very quickly. There was, like, lots of conflict as well as joy. It was a pretty confusing time.
What was his health like?
He was quite unhealthy. I didn't really realise it at the time, but post-stroke he would have developed... Well, not everyone, but a lot of people who have strokes, when they start to get dementia, it can be quite aggressive. So I didn't recognise the dementia. My father had been an alcoholic and had some mental health issues. So what it looked like, you know, alcoholism or anxiety and things like that was actually probably more dementia.
Your father became unwell and died 4 years after you first made contact with him.
Yeah.
What was that like for you?
When he died, I felt like I didn't have the right to grieve him. And all of those layers, like, it made me shift in my grief for my mother as well. Like, some of the anger that I thought I'd healed came back. It was really isolating, and I felt this shame for my brother. My brother's grieving and I didn't feel like I had the right to join him. We're incredibly close, and so that was... I felt terrible about that too. I couldn't join him in his grief for our father.
How do you reflect on your mother's betrayal now?
I really feel for my father, who probably was robbed of the most. And my kids didn't have an uncle. My brother didn't get to be that uncle in those earlier years. And my brother's an only child as well. So, you know, he had this incredibly lonely existence, and now he's got a sister and nieces and nephews. And, like, I forgive her. I've forgiven my mum for a lot of things. But the impact for me is that I've also had to question all of the stories that I believed from my childhood, the things that I thought I knew about myself, my identity. Everything's been kind of rattled, I guess.
Kath, your son Jared was caught up in the Centrelink robo-debt scheme and he ended up taking his own life. You gave evidence at the Royal Commission into the scheme. Why did you want to do that?
There was quite a few reasons. So that it never happened to another mother. Obviously, I wanted to see him, the justice. And the pursuit of truth, I really needed to find out what happened, and that, you know, 4 years of not actually knowing exactly what happened is, it just plays tricks on your mind all the time. It's like it keeps me awake overnight thinking that doesn't fit there, why doesn't it fit there? So, yeah, I just had to keep going until such time as...
The Commission found robo-debt was inept in dealing with vulnerable people. Mm-hmm. What do you make of the Commission's findings?
I think the Commission's findings were beyond my expectations. The Commissioner and all of the team of the Robo-Debt Royal Commission did a wonderful job, and I think they thoroughly went through it and understood the damage that it had caused.
Is there anything, do you think, that could restore your trust after what you describe as a government betrayal?
It's difficult now for me to deal with departments because I don't know what's truth and what's not. But hopefully, if I, you know, if these recommendations come into place, also if the government were held responsible for what occurred there, it may stop them from doing something like this in the future. And I think accountability is probably the word I'm looking for in deterring governments from just rolling ahead programs without any duty of care to who they're serving.
Kath, thank you so much. Thank you to you all for sharing so honestly in this room. Thank you too for joining us. You can catch up on this episode or any others on SBS On Demand. I'll see you next time.